bones are as fragile as mine. I have my flaws, but they have the same kind. I was ashamed, 'cause I couldn't see that grace says that they're in the same boat as me. But what I lack, you are full of, and where I'm broken, you are whole, and what I'm doubting, you are sure of. So I'll trust the lover, lover of my soul. I'm not afraid of the arrows by day, nor the darkness that comes when the sun rolls away. Lord, you know that my strength never lasts, but you make up for every weakness I have. And what I lack, you are full of, and where I'm broken, you are whole, and what I'm doubting, you are sure of. I'll trust the lover,
good morning everybody that is listening to the replays, everybody that is here, and also everybody on my YouTube channel. Welcome to Study Hall in the Pace Place, and we are going to get right into it. I'm going to go ahead and open us up in prayer, and then we're going to read the reading, we're going to listen to the reading for today. So most gracious and heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Father God. We thank you for another opportunity that we have here in the land of the living to be able to just serve you, God, to be able to praise you, to be able to worship you, God, to be able to hear your word, to see your word, God, to read your word, and to just meditate on your word, God. We just thank you. We thank you for the word. We thank you for everything that is going to go forth in the room today. And Lord God, I just ask that you just allow your will to be done, Lord God, through your word, through me, God, and whichever way that you see fit for me to edify your people today. And just continue to give me the things that I need to say, Lord God, because I never want to speak out of turn, Lord God. I only want to speak what you have set before me, Lord. And so I just continue to praise you, to bless you, to honor you, to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Okay, so today we are coming from 1 Chronicles chapter 17. Here we go.
1 Chronicles 17. Now when David lived in his house, David said to Nathan the prophet,
"Behold, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of the covenant of the Lord is under a tent."
And Nathan said to David,
"Do all that is in your heart, for God is with you."
But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan.
Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, it is not you who will build me a house to dwell in, for I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up Israel to this day, but I have gone from tent to tent and from dwelling to dwelling. In all places where I have moved with all Israel, did I speak a word with any of the judges of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus shall you say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you have gone, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a name like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in their own place and be disturbed no more. And violent men shall waste them no more as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will subdue all your enemies. Moreover, I declare to you that the Lord will build you a house. When your days are fulfilled to walk with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, one of your own sons, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for me, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. I will not take my steadfast love from him as I took it from him who was before you, but I will confirm him in my house and in my kingdom forever, and his throne shall be established forever.
In accordance with all these words and in accordance with all this vision, Nathan spoke to David. Then King David went in and sat before the Lord and said,
who am I, O Lord God, and what is my house that you have brought me thus far? And this was a small thing in your eyes, O God. You have also spoken of your servant's house for a great while to come, and have shown me future generations, O Lord God. And what more can David say to you for honoring your servant? For you know your servant. For your servant's sake, O Lord, and according to your own heart, you have done all this greatness in making known all these great things. There is none like you, O Lord, and there is no God besides you, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And who is like your people Israel, the one nation on earth whom God went to redeem to be his people, making for yourself a name for great and awesome things, in driving out nations before your people whom you redeemed from Egypt? And you made your people Israel to be your people forever, and you, O Lord, became their God. And now, O Lord, let the word that you have spoken concerning your servant and concerning his house be established forever, and do as you have spoken, and your name will be established and magnified forever, saying, the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, is Israel's God, and the house of your servant David will be established before you. For you, my God, have revealed to your servant that you will build a house for him. Therefore your servant has found courage to pray before you. And now, O Lord, you are God, and you have promised this good thing to your servant. Now you have been pleased to bless the house of your servant, that it may continue forever before you. For it is you, O Lord, who have blessed, and it is blessed forever.
All right, let's go back. All right, so this is going to be good. I literally say this about every single chapter, but that's fine because every single chapter of the word of the Lord is good, okay? He saw it fit for it to be good. So let's go ahead and go right back up to chapter, to verse 1, okay? And it reads, now when David lived in his house, David said to Nathan the prophet, behold, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of covenant of the Lord is under a tent. Verse 2, and Nathan said to David, do all that is in your heart, for God is with you. Verse 3, but that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan. Okay, so before we get into what God said to Nathan, right, we can see here, first of all, this chapter, if we're looking at chronological order, chapter 17 actually came after chapter 18, but for some reason, they kind of put it, you know, vice versa. So I find that to be very interesting, right? That it's not in the correct order, one. And in this first verse, we can see here that David is making a statement. He's like, you know, God is out there. His ark is in a tent. I'm living in a house of cedar. And in this time, we have to understand that cedar, if anybody would live in a house of cedar, in this time, they had money. Like they lived in a very expensive house, right? It was valuable because the cedar wood was the most valuable wood, to build anything with in this time. So David's living in a nice luxurious house, and he's like feeling remorseful, right? He's feeling bad of the contrast between his house and the tent that the Ark of Covenant is in outside. He's like, well, my house is much nicer. You know, I want to build God a house. And Nathan, the prophet, is telling David in verse 2, do all that is in your heart, right? For God is with you. And even though God is with him, we have to look at what Nathan said, right? He is the prophet. So he's supposed to speak the word of the Lord. And it's interesting to see here in these specific words how Nathan is speaking from his worldly, right? His worldly common sense, pretty much. And it's not even anything that David is saying that is wrong. It's just the fact that when we really think about it, God has been dwelling, the ark has been dwelling in a tabernacle for more than 400 years at this point. God has never commanded Moses or any of the other prophets after him specifically to build him an actual temple. And that was because of the fact that God already saw provision, right? That the ark would be stolen, that they were traveling in the wilderness for 40 years, right? They were moving around. The Ark of Covenant was going all around. So if they would have built an actual temple, they would have to build like so many temples because they were constantly moving. The ark was constantly being moved to other cities, other places. It actually ended up getting stolen. So we can see here that David had to go get it back, and they brought it back to Jerusalem. It was originally in Gibeon, you know, so it's a lot of things, a lot of movement going on with this ark, right? So God is telling them in Exodus chapter 25, let me read it. Okay. Exodus chapter 25, verse 8. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst, exactly as I show you concerning the pattern of the tabernacle and of all its furniture, so shall you make it. So he's telling them here, build me a tabernacle. He doesn't want a temple because he knows that a permanent building was not the right thing because of the fact that this ark would be moving all over Israel. And, you know, it would have been a waste of time. So the tent of meetings, also known as the tabernacle, was a perfectly suited dwelling place for the ark while the people were in the wilderness, while the Israelites were, you know, walking around, and they were constantly moving about. So now that Israel is securely in the land, and David is like, you know, I think it would be better and more appropriate to have a temple to replace this tabernacle. And it's absolutely nothing wrong with this, but we can see here that what exactly is in David's heart. He wants to do more for the Lord. In his heart, he's asking God, like, what can I do for you, God? What is something else? Like, he's really showing his gratitude, and we can see just how it is coming out of him, even from the previous chapters that we were reading, while he was doing all those sacrifices and he was seeking after the Lord guidance and direction when it came to even bringing the ark out of Gibeon, out of Obed-Edom's house, right? We can just see David's heart posture. And through reading this, I can also understand why God has called David, you know, a man after my own heart. Because when we really look at David's reputation and his history throughout, you know, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, now we're in 1 Chronicles, we can just see just how David desired to please God in all that he did, right? So I find this to be very interesting. Just the fact that his gratitude and his concern for God's glory, that he wanted to make something special for God to dwell in. He wanted a tent for, you know, God to physically dwell in. And so I just find this to be just amazing. And also as life application, right, for us. So if we really think about the things that we do, what are our desires? What is in our hearts, right? Is it serving the Lord? Is it to do more than he commanded for us? Is it to really show him our gratitude, you know, for all of the things that he has done for us, all of the things that he has pulled us out of? And I love this. And then Nathan's response to him, and he's a prophet, right? He's on David's staff, right? His team. And of course, David is the king. So the prophet is like, well, you want to build God a temple? That sounds good to me. Do what is in your heart, is what he's telling him. For God is with you. So we can kind of see that Nathan's response to David, just, it was a little presumptuous, right? And he didn't wait, because we can see in verse 4, I'm going to read it now, that just how the word of the Lord came to him in verse 4. If he would have just waited, you know, a day that night, because that night the word of the Lord did come. It did come to the prophet to give him specific instructions on what to tell David according to what he wanted to do and build for God. So let's go ahead and read verse 4. It reads, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, it is not you who will build me a house to dwell in. Verse 5. For I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up Israel to this day, but I have gone from tent to tent, from dwelling place to dwelling place. Verse 6, and this in all places where I have moved with all Israel, the judges of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar?" So this is God speaking to the prophet Nathan. And he's telling him, go and tell David that you ain't gonna build me no house. You know, you're not gonna build me a house because I have not lived in a house since I brought the people out of Egypt. Right? He's clearly saying here in verse 5, I have gone from tent to tent to dwelling, from dwelling place to dwelling place. And I have no problem with that, right? He didn't ask none of the other judges. He didn't ask not Moses, not nobody, to build him in an exclusive house where he can dwell in, you know, in one specific location. So we can see here how the correction came, right? So after Nathan has gave his opinion, right, his presumptuous opinion of what David wanted to do, he's like, yeah, do what's in your heart. You know, God has come to vindicate this issue. And it's not even an issue. It's just the fact that this plan to build God a temple is not David's calling. This is going to be the calling of his son, right? And we know that from later on in scripture. We're going to read how David's son Solomon is going to be the one who builds God the temple. We can also read that in 1st and 2nd Kings, how Solomon is the one who's going to reign on the throne, and he's going to be the one that God calls to build him an actual temple, okay? And so we can see, like, even from this, when God is talking to Nathan, he seems kind of surprised to me. He's like, I've never stayed in a tent or a temple. I've been in tents. I've been in dwelling places. So you want to build me a house, you know? And he's telling him, no, tell him no, right? And that I've never commanded anyone to do this, and I'm not about to start now. okay? Because it's not the time. And we have to understand that God works at appointed times. So just because it's a good idea for us and we feel like, you know, it's a legitimate idea, it's, you know, it's a good thing. Sometimes the good things that we want to do, it's not for us to do. And we can see this here in David. This is not his calling. This is not what God had called him to do or to be, right? And he's going to explain this. Nathan is going to go ahead and explain this to David. And we know, right, that in this entire thing, I don't want to be like jumping too far ahead, but in 1 Chronicles 29, even though David was not the one who was going to build the temple, he ultimately was going to bring all the supplies. He's going to order everything and make sure that Solomon has all that he needs for construction in order to build God this glorious temple. So we can just see from that, like, even though God has not called us to do a certain thing, it doesn't mean that we cannot help, right? It doesn't mean that we just sit back and be like, well, since you won't want me to do it, then I'm gonna just sit over here in the corner or whatever. You know, we still are called to help our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And it just reminds me of this analogy that I heard about birthing a baby, right? When you have something that you want to birth out, an idea or an actual physical baby, right? The mother is not the first person to hold the blessing in her hand. The blessing is given to her baby, by the doctor, right? The doctor is the one that actually grabs the child out, pulls the baby out, cleans him up, wraps him in the little blanket, and then hands over to the mother. So this is basically what I'm thinking about as this is going on, because even though David wants to birth this blessing, he wants to birth out a temple for God, his son is going to be the one to do it. And then he's going to hand the blessing to his son for his son to be able to physically build it up for God. So I love that. And we have to have that same mentality. When we get a no from God, it's okay. It's okay that God said no, right? Because it just means that it's his will, and we just have to trust that his will is better and perfect and better than anything we could ever imagine. And it doesn't mean that we can't still help out in the process, even though we are not the ones who's going to physically fulfill whatever it is that God has, you know, called and instructed, but we can still help the other person who is called to do that specific thing for the Lord. So, all right, amen. That's very good. So verse 7 reads, "Now therefore shall you say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel." And I find this to be interesting too, because he calls David a prince. Okay, so that's the first thing. I'm going to go ahead and keep reading in verse 8. "And I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a name like the name of the great ones of the earth." Verse 9, "And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, that they may dwell in their own place and be disturbed no more. And violent men shall waste them no more as formerly." Verse 10, "For the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will subdue all your enemies. Moreover, I declare to you that the Lord will build you a house." Ah, man, this is good. This is good. So David, his original proposal to the Lord, right, is rejected. We see that God say, no, we're not going to do that. And he doesn't even do it in a way where he's just like shutting down his plan, right? He's doing it in a way where he's reminding David just where I brought you from, right? That you may believe, right, to to continue to believe in the amazing promises, because I have, remember you were in the pasture, remember where I have brought you from, right? And now look at you now. That's the first thing. And then he tells him the promise. Instead of you building me a house, I'm gonna build you a house, right? So this just shows just how good God is and God's promises for David that he will build him a house, right? And it's interesting because the word house here in Hebrew, it could mean dynasty. It could mean an actual house, a temple, even a household. So I just find that to be just amazing, right? In the sense of establishing a dynasty for the house of David. And we know that our Lord and Savior, Jesus, came from David's lineage. So when he's telling him in this instance, I will build you a house, he's ultimately talking about his physical house with his son, you know, Solomon, who's going to reign after him, but also the spiritual house where Jesus is going to be able to come and establish his kingdom through David's lineage forever. And I love that. God be good. He be good on the words. Like when he be saying stuff, you know, it be good. Okay. So even though David wanted to build him a temple, God was like, no, thank you. I'm going to build you a house and watch this, right? So we can see here just how good God is. And to understand and to know like why God told David no, and it's because David was a man of war. It was his destiny to be, you know, who he is, which is a warrior, right? And God's house ultimately is going to be built by a man of peace, right? And we know that Solomon's name means peace. So God is very intricate with his word. He's very intricate with the way that he does things through the people in the Bible. So I just find this to be very, very interesting. If we even go to 1 Chronicles 22, verses 8 and 10, right? It says, but the word of the Lord came to me saying, you have shed much blood and have made great wars. You shall not build a house for my name, because you have shed much blood on the earth in my sight. A son shall be born to you who shall be a man of rest. You see that? He shall be to build a house for my name. So we can just see God's plan, how it's just going to unfold. And it's interesting to see that, this description here in 1 Chronicles 22, verses 8 and 10, because the Lord doesn't, you know, the word doesn't give us that information in 1st, 2nd Samuel or 1st and 2nd Kings. So to see this here in 1st Chronicles, how David is specifically speaking to David and telling him just how and what he is going, how the temple is going to be built, and to know who's going to do it specifically and the reason why. So I find that to be very, very, very interesting, right? And it just goes to show like our relationship with God is always based upon what he does for us, right? Never based upon what we do for him, because it's like, come on, what can we physically do for God? The things that we can do for him, it doesn't create us any merit. It doesn't give us any claim to anything, but it's for him to just continuously just show us just how much he loves us, for us to fall into line, into full submission and obedience to him. Like that's the ultimate sacrifice that we can give the Lord, not what we can physically build for him with our hands or physically do with for him, but it's to just fall in line with his will and his way, and to obey and trust that his plan and his will is perfect, and we have nothing to worry about. Okay. So we're going to go down here to verse 11, and it reads, when your days are fulfilled to walk with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, one of your sons, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for me, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. I will not take my steadfast love from him as I took it from him who was before you. But I will confirm him in my house and in my kingdom forever, and his throne shall be established forever in accordance with all these words and in accordance with all this vision Nathan spoke to David. So that was 11 to 15 that I just read. And I like that. I like the forever. just because this is a covenant that God is establishing here with David through the prophet Nathan. So he's like, I will set you right up. I'm going to establish your house, your heirs. And it's just interesting to see in this how God is specifically promising a monarchy for the house of David. It's just so good. It's important for God to repeat the promise specifically. That's why I feel like he said forever multiple times, right? Because there has never yet been a king that has succeeded the throne that by his son, like the son has, it has been passed down, right? In Israel, we know that King Saul was the first king of Israel, and what happened, his whole house died. And even though one of his sons did reign for a couple of days, he ended up getting murdered, you know, because they basically saw his weakness, and they were like, we're just gonna take this man out. And he was a young boy, a teenager most likely, and he was killed. So we can see here that there has not been a successful successor of the throne until we get to David and his lineage, and I find that to be just so interesting. So in the word inherit, right, in the Hebrew, y'all know I like the Hebrew words, right, because it just gives a deeper understanding and also revelation of the word and what God is really saying when we can take it back to the original language, right? So the word inherit, the word is zerah in Hebrew. And when we translate that really over to English, it could mean seed, it can mean offspring, it could mean individual members, member household members, right? It has so many different aspects of it, and we can see how they all can apply to the dynasty of the whole aspect of what God is promising. So not only with his actual physical seed, which would be his son, but the spiritual seed that's going to be born, birthed from this lineage in later on, you know, years after this, how Jesus is going to come right through this lineage. This is amazing. Oh man. So God is basically establishing this covenant with him, and he has revealed the predestined order that's going to happen. And he's saying that he is going to reign. He's going to be my son, and he is going to reign forever. Right. And what does it say? Let me go back to it. He shall build a house for me. Yes. He shall build a house for me. This is verse 12, and I will establish his throne forever. Okay. And then we jump down to verse 13. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Okay. This is good. I just can't help but think about Jesus, man. Okay. So, verse 14, it says, but I will confirm him in my house. So this is God's house in heaven. Okay. His heaven is not down here. Okay. So he will confirm him in his house and in my kingdom in heaven forever. Okay. And his throne will be established forever. So that's three forevers. Okay. That's just good for me. That's really, truly, truly amazing. Just how we can see, or not see, but we can read. Well, we can see it. We can see it because I'm reading it. But we can just read just how God is telling David through the prophet Nathan that his kingdom is going to reign forever. And we know that that's going to happen through Jesus, who is the Son of God. And if we even take it all the way to Jeremiah, right? We go to Jeremiah 23, verse 5. It says, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise to David a branch of righteousness. A king shall reign and prosper and execute righteousness in the earth. Now this, right, is his name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness." That is just amazing. Like, God is good. God is, he's good. And you know, like, the way that he writes the Bible, it just be having me sucked in. I don't know about y'all, but I be getting sucked into that thing because it just be too good. I be telling people all the time, this is the best book I have ever read. It got everything in it. When I say everything, I mean everything. Okay, because even if we go to Luke 1 and 31, where he's telling Mary, "You're going to have a son. You're going to call him Jesus, and he's going to be the Son of God," right? And he's coming for the throne of David, and he's going to reign forever, and, you know, his kingdom will never end. This is what he's telling, you know, Mary and Joseph about the son that they're going to, well, that Mary's going to have, right? And how he is going to just be the reigning king forever. His kingdom will never end. So I love this, right? And we can see here in First Chronicles just how we are talking about the Messiah and his dynasty and the result of his throne through God, through this specific lineage, right? So we can just see this spiritual house is going to be built up, okay? And so I feel like that's another reason why God is also telling David, we can't build up the physical until we get the spiritual in line, right? So once we get that spiritual lineage going and build up the spiritual house so that Jesus can have his lineage established in the spiritual realm, then we can focus on, you know, a physical tabernacle a physical tent, temple for the ark to dwell in. So I love this. This is amazing. God is, he's good. Okay, so now we're going to go down to verse 16. Okay, then King David went in and sat before the Lord and said, "Who am I, O Lord God, and what is my house that you have brought me thus far?" This is good because, okay, so we can just see even from the beginning of this prayer, because he has come into the house of the Lord. So now he's inside of the tent, right? This same tent that he wants to get rid of and he wants to build a temple. God says no. So now he goes into the tent and he's praying to the God. And David's humbleness, right, in this praise to God, he's not coming in here with like, why you don't want me to build it? What, like, what's up? You know, no. He's like, now he's like, well, you gonna build me a house? Why am I so special, God, right, that you have brought me this far? And we go to verse 17, and it reads, "And this was a small thing in your eyes, O God. You have also spoken of your servant's house for a great while to come, and have shown me future generations, O Lord God. And what more can David say to you for honoring your servant? For you know your servant." This prayer is so humbling. This is why I love David. David is just good, y'all. Yeah, we got to really get up into David. Okay, because this is amazing. So verse 19, it says, "For your servant's sake," again, he says, "for your servant." He doesn't even see himself. He's the king at this point. And he's coming to God so humbly as just a simple servant. He said, "For your servant's sake, O Lord, and according to your own heart, You have done all this greatness in making known all these great things. There is none like you, O Lord, and there is no God besides you, according to all that we have heard in our ears. Verse 21. And who is like your people Israel, the one nation on earth whom God went to redeem to be his people, making for yourself a name for great and awesome things, and driving out nations before your people whom you redeemed from Egypt? Verse 22, and you made your people of Israel to be your people forever, and you, O Lord, became their God. So I'm going to stop there. Okay. So this is good. Okay. First of all, this prayer is so humbling. It makes me think about how I pray to God. David has received the most spectacular gift. He didn't think that it made him any greater in the sight of the Lord or any in the sight of the other people. God said, I'm gonna build you a house, and in your house, your seed will reign forever as the king over Israel. And he comes to God so humbly, and he's like, God, what makes me so special, Lord? He's giving the honor back to God and telling him, like, no, you're great. I am just your servant. And his attitude toward the whole thing, it just shows how good God is, first of all, because God is so great that he gives the right gifts. He gives the gifts, right? And when he gives the gifts, they are blessings. They are to be received as blessings. And with that same attitude, David is putting the attention and the greatness not on himself, because he's like, well, God blessed me and he told me he was going to do this, so I must be great. No, he's putting the attention on the giver and just saying how I'm your servant and how I'm going to humbly put the attention back on you, because it could have been easily for Nathan to say, well, David must be so great, right, that God is going to establish his kingdom forever, because we have to understand, too, that the word came through Nathan. So, and Nathan was the one who gave the word to David. And so to see David go into the tent, and I'm pretty sure, because I would have been eavesdropping. So I don't know, we're not gonna assume, but you know, it was a tent and it was no walls, so if you go in there and you be praying, I'm pretty sure people could hear you praying. Okay, so I'm pretty sure Nathan heard David humbly in there accepting God's no. First of all, he has accepted the no from God. And in even doing that, accepting the no, when he wanted to build God a temple, there are still, right, some professors who would do a great thing, you know, if they have the mic, right? And then they would be like, well, you know, I'm good, or be angry because God told them no and I'm trying to do a good thing. But David and his proposal, it was set aside, and he found it in his heart not to murmur, not to complain, not to feel like he's so mighty and great, I won all these wars and you don't even want me to build you no temple, but to pray. Man, that's good, right? The king is sitting before the Lord, right? Oh man, praying and trusting in his plan and showing his humility as a servant to God. He said servant multiple times, right? It was repeated, I'm your servant, and just putting all of the greatness back onto the giver of this ultimate blessing, right? I just feel like this is just truly amazing, and God is amazing. God is truly amazing. David is amazing, right? And David boldly asks for that promise to be fulfilled, right? We're going to go ahead and read how he boldly asks for the promise to be fulfilled. But I just find this to be so just truly amazing that this great king, this great king. This is the greatest king to this day, because we know Saul was just not it, okay? So David is a great king, and he does not even see himself as any of a higher stature when he goes before the Lord. And we have to take on that same posture. And it's so funny because I was reading in Deuteronomy yesterday how Moses prostrated himself when he prayed before the Lord. And when I search up the word prostrate, it means to be on your knees, face down to the ground in full submission to God. So I can just imagine even David being in that state of prostrate when he's talking to God in this moment, because of just by the things that he is saying, and that he didn't think it to be he didn't think himself to be made greater, right? Like in David's eyes, it made God greater that he was even considering blessing him in such a way that his kingdom would reign forever. And I just love that. And even if we go to the New Testament, we can see multiple accounts where Jesus and David is being compared as far as coming from his lineage, right? In Matthew chapter 21, verse 9, it says, "Hosanna to the son of David." In Luke 1:32, it says, "The Lord God will give him the throne from his father David." And even in Revelation, it reads, "I am," this is Jesus talking at this, "I am the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star." Like, truly amazing. That's just some of the accounts, right? I just find that to be just, it warms my heart, okay? I don't know about y'all, but this is good. This is really good. So now we're going to go ahead and get into verse 23, and it reads, "And now, O Lord, let the word that you have spoken concerning your servant again, and concerning his house be established forever. And do as you have spoken." Verse 24, "And your name will be established and magnified forever, saying, the Lord of hosts, the Lord God of Israel is Israel's God. And the house of your servant David will be established before you." Okay, we're going to stop there. This is verse 23 and 24. So look, David is praying, okay? His prayer is bold. He's asking God, "Okay, God, you said it. I'm going to trust in your promise." This is not a passive prayer. This is not a arrogant prayer, right? This is a bold prayer that said, "God, here is your promise, God. This is what you said to me. Now I trust you to fulfill it grandly," because he said forever, okay? "And I'm going to be faithful to your word." And we know that David is going to be faithful to the word of the Lord. And I just love this, right? And the phrase that he keep emphasizing this, "your servant." He's like, "I'm only praying this prayer because you promised. You told me that this is what you are going to do to establish my house. So I'm going to accept the no from you to build up your temple. And I'm going to also accept the promise that you have made to me to build up my house. And not only am I going to accept the promise, but I'm going to also walk boldly, okay, in your statutes, in your word, in your law, and have faith that you will do exactly what you said you're going to do, right? This kind of prayer just, it just shows David's appreciation for God's promise. And just because God has promised it does not mean that we will possess the promise, right? Because we know that David is not going to physically possess this promise, but the lineage of him will be great. And this is what it's the same promise as Abraham, right? When God promised Abraham that he will have multiple kids, the number of the sea, the number of the sands, right, of the stars, right, is not a promise that Abraham is going to physically be able to see for himself, right, in his lifetime. And this is the same thing that we're seeing here with David, right? But he has so much faith that even though he's not going to be here to see it, God's promises will not be left unclaimed. This is just truly amazing, right? We can appreciate his promise for forgiveness. We can appreciate his promise for peace. We can appreciate his promises for guidance. We can appreciate his promises for growth, okay? Because God's promises will never, okay, never. And we can be boldly in it and know that if he said it, he is gonna do it. And it ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. I love to say, if God said it, we could take it to the bank and cash it. It ain't gonna bounce. That's a check that is not gonna bounce, okay? It's gonna clear. Don't mind me, y'all. Don't. But I just love that. I love it. And we can notice that David's heart, right? He prayed from the heart. He was not praying from a book, right? He was not praying from his head. He prayed from the right place to pray from, which is the heart. And we can just, yeah, it's just amazing. Amazing. Okay, so now we read in verse 25. For you, my God, have revealed to your servant. Here we go with your servant again. I'm gonna have to count up these your servants because, baby, he was not playing. I'm your servant, God. Use me, okay? You have revealed to your servant that you will build a house for him. Therefore, your servant has found courage to pray before you. Verse 26, and now, O Lord, you are God, and you have promised these good things to your servant. Verse 27, which is the last verse. Now you have been pleased to bless the house of your servant, that it may continue forever before you. For it is you, O Lord, who have blessed, and it is blessed forever. This is good. Okay, so we can just see here how David is basically, he is literally, okay, going on faith at this point. This is David's foundation of faith. He's like, you said it, God. This is what it's going to be. You have revealed these things to your servant, that you will build up your servant's house, and therefore your servant has found courage, right? So we can see here that the word of God, is it even gives us courage. So we can even appreciate his promise to help us. Man, like, this is good, okay? He has found courage in the word. So his faith is being built up at this point. So he knew that God was God, right? He knew this already, and that his promises was true, and that he can trust in God. God can be trusted, and not just like a physical trust, but like in his heart, in the depths of his heart, in the inner chambers of his being. He has found courage to even pray before him about the promises that God has revealed to him. Right? And he's saying that the greatest thing that you can give me is your promise. And I will have faith in that. I will trust in that. I find courage in that. And I am going to walk in your way, and I'm going to believe in the promises that you have. Right? He says here in verse 26, you are God, and you have promised this good thing to your servants. Now you have been pleased to bless the house of your servant. Okay, so he's saying that he's still putting the attention on God and not on himself. And he's still referring to himself as your servant. This is just amazing that it may continue forever before you. For it is you, O God, who have blessed, and it is blessed forever. He is reiterating the promises to God in prayer. Because God, you said this, because you have revealed this to me, I'm going to trust in it. I'm going to have confidence in it. I'm going to believe in it, right? I am going to derive my courage and my being from what you have given me, from what you have said. Thus said the Lord, right? We saw that in the previous verse. Thus says the Lord, right? And God is not a God who is a liar. We know this from scripture. So if God has said something, he is going to fulfill it. He's going to watch over his word so that he is faithful to perform it. And we can see down through the line, right? After Solomon, and after he makes his mistakes with his multiple wives and things like that, how it kind of seems like the throne of David is abandoned, but we can still trust him and know that it doesn't matter how many years it takes, God is faithful to perform his word. So even though it looks like, you know, other people from other lineages has rose up to reign on the throne, and we're going to see how all of those other kings are going to come and they just going to be horrible kings, right? We can see all of that, and it kind of looks like the promise that God gave was abandoned. But the fact that it is even being uttered in this chapter, it just shows that it does not matter what it may look like to us. But God always, right, when he gives a word, it's always going to be fulfilled at the appointed time. And we can trust in that, and we can know and have faith. And even though we may not see it in our lifetime, but to know that our lineage, who we leave behind, is going to continue on with following the word of God and trusting in the word of God, believing in the word of God, finding courage in the word of God, and to know that God is faithful to perform his word. Amen. So that is it. I'm going to end us off in a devotion. Okay. And today's devotion reads, God will refresh your soul. Okay. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. This is verse 20, Psalms 23, verses 2 and 3. Psalms 23 is one of the most encouraging psalms in the Bible. It gives us many promises, including the refreshing of our souls. The soul consists of the mind, will, and emotions. And just as our bodies need rest and refreshing, so does our soul. This is so good, because I'm going to stop right here, y'all, because the song that I played in the opening of the room was Lover of My Soul. And that is my all-time favorite song, right? And the fact that this devotion is even talking about this is just good, okay? So it reads, Is your mind tried and weary from worry, reasoning, and trying to figure out what you should do about your problems? Are your emotions frazzled and on edge due to being upset or angry about things other people have that you don't have? Is your will weak from trying to be determined to stay strong while feeling that you consistently fail? If so, I know how you feel, because we all experience feelings such as these at times. According to Psalms 23, the Lord is your shepherd. You will lack nothing, and he will make you lie down in green pastures, lead you beside the quiet waters, and refresh your soul. You don't have to work all the time or worry about how to solve your problems. You can take time to be refreshed and nourished. If you don't, you will definitely become weary. And weariness almost always causes us to make bad decisions. Spend time regularly with God in a quiet place and let his presence refresh you and restore you. Time with God is a valuable investment every day. prayer. Father, thank you that you will refresh my soul. Help me be wise enough to spend time with you regularly and give you an opportunity to bring refreshment to my life. Amen and amen. That was good. Okay. That was really good. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and close us out in prayer. And I'll see y'all here tomorrow, okay? Most gracious and heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Father God. We thank you for your reading today, Father God. And we thank you for the devotion, Lord God. We even thank you for the song that was played in the beginning of the room, Lord God. And we appreciate you. We appreciate your alignment because it's truly amazing. And we just love you, God. And we just appreciate the fact that you are the lover of our souls and you know exactly what to do with us, Father God. And we just thank you for that. We just love you, God. We continue to worship you and praise you. And I just ask that as we leave from this place, Lord, you just continue to dwell in us, Lord God. Continue to allow your Holy Spirit to lead and guide us and just continue to show us exactly who we are in you, Lord God, in your word, Lord God. Just continue to give us a desire to seek after you, to seek after your word and what you have in store for us, Lord God, because we know that it is not by our merits. It's not about anything that we can do, Lord God, but it's all about you, Lord. It's all about what you have in store for us and what you can do for us, Lord God. And so we just thank you for it now in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. All right. Thank you all for joining me in the Pace Place.